Hey guys, welcome back to Labor Laws Lecture Series. We are discussing about Labor Law 1 paper of KSLU LLB course. And earlier we discussed about Unit 1 and now we are discussing about Unit 4. This is the third video with respect to Unit 4. And in the first video, we discussed the concept and importance of the Social Security. And in the second video, we discussed about overview of Employee Compensation Act 1923. And in this video, we are going to discuss about two major definitions. One is dependent and the second one is employee. So in a general terms, right, in a simple term, the dependent refers to a person who depends upon another for a livelihood, for a day-to-day expenses, for a food, for travel, for clothes and other things. If one person is depending on other, one person who is completely depends on other is called as a dependent, right? Well, normally, a child's are dependent on father for earnings. If wife is not working, so mother also will be the dependent on father's earning, correct? So this is how the general definition of a dependent. But according to section 21D of Employees Compensation Act of 1923, they have classified three categories of dependents. Okay, the first one, which is a straightforward, a widow, a wife of a person who dies, and then a minor, whether it is a minor is a legitimate or adopted son. Okay, minor, legitimate or adopted son, and unmarried, legitimate or adopted daughter. Okay, minor son here, and then unmarried daughters, whether legitimate or adopted, it is important. Illegitimate is not part of category one, or a widowed mother. If father is not alive, then the mother will also become dependent. If father is there, then the mother will not be dependent on child's son's income. Okay, so this is the first category: a widow, a minor, legitimate or adopted son, unmarried daughter, whether legitimate or adopted is both, and then widowed mother. Okay, this is the first category. So let's next look into a second category. This says, if a person is more than 18 years, whether it is a son or a daughter, even if they attend 18 years, but if they are infirm, means if they have some physical challenges or mental illness, so they are not fit, okay, mental illness. In these cases, the persons will be considered as dependent. Here we said only a minors are considered. If the health of a person is not right, and if he is not given a position to earn, even if he is more than 18 years, because of a physical challenges or a mental illness, then that person will be considered as dependent. This is the second set of dependents. And the third set of dependents, it is little complicated here. The first here is they have to prove that they are dependent on the employee who has died during an accident. Okay, they have to prove that they are dependent on that particular person. The first one is a widower. If a wife dies, then husband has to prove that he is dependent on wife's income, then only will be considered as dependent. Okay, and then parents other than the widowed mother, it's a father. If father also can claim that he is a, if he is a dependent on son's income, then a minor illegitimate son and unmarried illegitimate daughter. Okay, these are the other set. A minor illegitimate son also can claim that he is a dependent, provided if he is really dependent on the income of his father. Okay, and same with an unmarried illegitimate daughter also. Okay, and other important point, a daughter, legitimate, illegitimate or adopted. A daughter who is a illegitimate or a legitimate or a adopted, but if she is widowed and if she is a minor. Okay, if minor daughter get married and then she is a widowed, in that case also, whether it is a legitimate, illegitimate or adopted, they will be considered as dependent. And then a minor brother, If minor brother proves that he is dependent on his brother's income, then he depends on his brother's income, then he will be considered as dependent. And the same way, unmarried sister, okay, or a widowed sister, if she is a minor. So all these people will also be considered as dependent if they prove that they are depending on the income of the died person for their livelihood. Okay. So in that case, they all will be considered as dependent. And the next category is widowed daughter-in-law. Daughter-in-law is son's wife. If a son is not there, then widowed daughter-in-law will be considered as minor. A minor child of a pre-deceased son. Okay, a minor child of a pre-deceased son will also be treated as dependent. A minor child of a pre-deceased daughter. No parents of the child is alive. If there is no mother is also not there and a father is also not there, then a minor child of a pre-deceased daughter will also be considered as dependent. And then finally, a parental grandparents if parents are not alive. Okay, if father, grandparent, parent, father and son here, sorry, father and mother, grandparent from a maternal side, and then son. Okay, if father and mother both are not there, then these grandparents will be considered as dependent on this particular son. Okay, so this is the third set, which is a little complicated. As I repeat once again, a widower, parent other than widowed mother, is that father, a minor illegitimate son, an unmarried illegitimate daughter, a daughter legitimate or illegitimate or adopted if she is married and a minor widowed or a minor. Okay, a minor brother or an unmarried sister or a widowed sister if she is a minor, a widowed daughter-in-law, a minor child of a predeceased son, a minor child of a predeceased daughter where no parents are alive, and parental grandparents if no parents are alive. Okay, this is a set of dependents according to section 2ID. Three categories. First category is a direct relationship, what we have. Second category, because of the illness and other things, if person is not, sons and daughters are not able to do it and not able to earn their livelihood, then it is called as dependent after 18 years. And the third set is a special category, which is an extended one. The spouse, like a male spouse, and then husband, and then father, and illegitimate sons, unmarried illegitimate daughters. If a daughter is married but she is minor, if daughter is married and she is widowed, and widowed daughter-in-law, it is the next level of relationship which brought into category 3 of an dependence. I hope you guys are very clear with the dependence definition here. Please go through this definition, which is given in section 2.1d of 2id or 2.1d of Employees Compensation Act of 1923. Okay, now it is time to look into a few case studies around this definition. The first one is, if infant is working, infant means a person less than 8 to 10 years of age, and if he is working and he dies in an accident, and the father can claim a compensation being a dependent, but he has to prove that he is dependent on the infant's income. Okay, this was held in the case of St. Joseph's Automobile and Mechanical Works versus Maria Susai Pillai. So this is a third category where father can claim that he is a dependent for an infant. The second case, a person dies and then his wife remarries. Will she be treated as a dependent? Yes, the law says that subsequent event cannot affect the claim. Okay, so the accident happens today, and after 3 months, if she marries, okay, she will be treated as dependent only, because this the marriage happened only after the death of a person, right? So that's why the subsequent events cannot affect the claim. This was discussed in the case of R.B. Mundra and Company versus Mrs. Banwari. Okay, if an illegitimate child born And then is if the father is a reputed person, if he is supported from a reputed father, then also that it be the illegitimate child will be treated as dependent. G.R. Sene versus D.S. Sonwane and Co. This was held in this particular case. Widowed mother, the definition, right? The first category says widowed mother, but widowed mother does not include stepmother. It is only the person's mother and not a stepmother. It was held in the case of Munno Devi versus Bengal Bone Mill case. The last one, mother is partially dependent even father is alive. Okay, in another definition it was said that if father is alive, widowed mother is a dependent, right? The first category of definition, if you see it, it says widowed mother. Yes, if father is alive also, mother is partially dependent. It was held in the case of Bakula Bai versus Rajani Bai case. Okay, this is a case where mother is also partially dependent, even father is alive. This was a key decision. So three categories of dependents and five case laws to give the meaning and definition of a dependents. I hope you guys are clear with the concept of dependent. Please go through the definition once again in detail and then look into these case studies. This clarifies most of the doubts. Moving to the next point. So far we discussed the employee many times, right? Who is employee now? Employee is someone in general sense, is someone who works under employer. Very simple definition. Employer will be there and he gives employment to many people. These persons will be called as employee. They will be working because of this employer. There is a master and servant relationship. Okay, but here who is an employee? According to section 21DD, earlier it was in 21N, and the latest amendment it has come down in 21DD, and 21N is omitted. Okay, so the same thing, they brought it here. There is no major change other than bringing it to section 21DD. Okay, according to this section 21DD, employee means a railway servant. Okay, they are classified by the jobs. Okay, there is a big list of job which is given in a schedule 2 of an schedule 2 of the Employees Compensation Act, but they have specifically mentioned the each and every job which can be called as an employee. One is a railway servant. Railway servant means the definition of a railway servant is given in section 2 of the Railways Act of 1989. Okay, it means the railway servant means who is not in an administrative or a subdivisional office. If who is not working on administrative matter, who is a servant of a railway, according to section 2 of a Railways Act, that person will be considered as an employee. And then a master, seaman and other members of the crew of the ship. Whoever is working in a ship, a master, seaman and any other servants or cleaners, everybody will be treated as, crew of the ship will be treated as employee. And again in case of aircraft, a captain and other members of the crew of an aircraft, other members of the aircraft are also will be treated as an employees, as employees. A person recruited as a driver, helper, mechanic, cleaner or in any other capacity in connection with a motor vehicle. Okay, we discussed about sea transport here, then air transport, now it is in road transport. So any person who is working, whether as a driver, helper, mechanic, cleaner, whatever, for a connection with a motor vehicle, will be called as an employee. A person recruited for work abroad by a company. If any person is recruited to work abroad in a foreign country by some other company, will be treated as an employee. He is an employee outside India. Okay, those employees which are mentioned in schedule 2, I have pasted schedule 2 at the end of this video. We will go through at a high level, not in detail. Okay, so whether it is a ship, aircraft or motor vehicle or any company, if they are working, then which are registered in India, that will be treated as an employee. The persons who are working in ship, aircraft, motor vehicle or in a company which is registered in India, that will be, those will be treated as an employees. Okay, the third one is, employed in any such capacity as specified in Schedule 2. As I said, Schedule 2 listed down each and every work that can be considered as an employee. So that we will see after this. Okay. These are the three categories which they have said. One is on a rail, and another one is sea transport, air transport, and then road transport, and then any companies. And the third one is employees who are listed in Schedule 2, whether in a contract of employment or a permanent employment. Okay, so that will be treated as an employee. This is a definition of an employee. Three major clauses in this. Okay. Okay, there is a one exception to it. The persons who are members of the armed forces of the union, they will not be considered as employees under section 21DD. Okay, so for all military, right, the military purpose, the labor laws will not apply to a military forces, because military works in a different capacity. Except the armed forces, this law will applicable to everyone. And there is another exception to employees, what we read about in section 21DD. One is, if a person is working on a casual nature, okay, employee does not include a person whose employment is of a casual nature. Casual nature means unrelated to employer's trade and business. If some person comes for cleaning, okay, cleaning or for small work, okay, dusting, cleaning of windows, for example, he comes for a day and does cleaning and goes out. In those cases, this will not be called as an employee. If he's coming for some small work, even in houses we see, right, there may be some patchwork will be needed or some tiles need to be fixed. For a small work, he comes and goes out, then that person will not be called as employee. He is a casual worker. So there is a difference between casual worker and temporary worker. Okay, these are two different words. Casual worker, which is not related to business, they come for very minor works. Okay, they come for some discussion, they may come for some small work like a plumbing or etc., which is not related to business. Okay, temporary worker is something different. If our employee is on leave, and then employer hires someone to fill the gap. If my driver is on leave, I take some other person as a driver, then this is a employee only. He will be considered as employee only. It is critical to the business. But the person who comes as a casual work and does for 10-15 minutes and goes out, he will be considered as a casual worker. Replacing existing employee for a temporary basis will be called as a temporary worker. They will also be termed as employee under section 21DD. So remember, casual workers are not employees, but temporary workers are employees. Okay, this is the point which we discuss now. Replacing employees during his leave tenure is not a casual worker. It is an employee only. In the case of Madan Lal versus Mangali, it was held that it is very difficult to lay down the precise test for determining whether a particular employment is of a casual nature or not. So it is very difficult, right? If plumber is not working on that, then it affects your business also. So it is very difficult to identify who is a casual, which work is a casual in nature, which work is a temporary. It is a question of fact to be determined on the fact and circumstances of the case. How we determine it? It is based on the fact and circumstance of the case and not of a law. So we cannot make any law which one is a casual work and which one is a temporary work. So this can be done only based on some of the facts and circumstances of the case. So every case should be reviewed with the case related facts and circumstances. Okay, so this is about casual worker and temporary worker. Is the time or a duration of a employment also affects to call him as an employee or a casual? No. That the time or a duration spent in an office is immaterial with respect to a casual worker or a worker. Okay, casual worker or a temporary worker or a permanent worker is all depends on the nature of the work, not on the time. Okay, whether he is worked for 2 days or 30 minutes or 40 days or 10 years. Okay, it doesn't matter. If the nature of the work they do is defines who is a casual worker and who is a worker. Okay, but not a time. It was held in the case of Patel Engineering Company Limited versus Commissioner of Employees Compensation Act, Commissioner of Employee Compensation, Hyderabad. Here, the daily wages who was working and died after 2 days of work. Okay, he worked only for 2 days and then he died. So, employer claimed that he is a casual worker because he worked only for 2 days. But this case was he was rejected, stating the duration of time is not important. The important is the nature of the work. Okay, that's why this was held in this particular case. Okay, onus of proving that is a casual work is on employer. It is a responsibility of the employer to prove that this particular work is a casual in nature, and they have to give details about why it is called as a casual worker. So this is about casual worker and a temporary work. But as we discussed earlier, right, is it easy to find out who is an employee and what is a casual work and other thing? There are tests here. This is a three-step test. One is whether there is a contract of employment. The person, whenever the employee comes into picture, there will be a contract of employment, whether explicit or implied. So this is the first one. Second one, there is a master and servant relationship. The one beauty of master and servant relationship is master gives directions, okay, and servant executes it. This is a major characteristics of a master and servant relationship. Whatever the directions of a master, servant has to follow it. He is a follower, he gives the direction. If this kind of relationship exists, and then employment is for the purpose of a trade or a business of the employer. If anyone is manufacturing something, and any work related to that will be called as an employment. If some small work, cleaning of windows and other things, are considered as a casual work. Okay, so these three are important tests. One is there must be a contract of employment, there must be a master and servant relationship, and employment is for the purpose of trade or business of the employer. If all the three are there, then it will be called as employee. The person will be called as employee. Okay, here is some leading cases decisions with respect to terms of employee. Okay, if any person comes and voluntarily assists the another man, then it will not be considered as employee. If some NGOs comes in to a factory premises and work or assist the existing employees, those employees will not be considered as those workers are not considered as employees under section 21DD of contract of employment. Sorry, section 21DD of Employee Compensation Act of 1923. Independent contractor is not an employee. This is the most important point when we discuss about the definition of employee. Please note that independent contractor means if a factory owner, they want to set up one small office building. Assume that the building to be constructed. This particular factory owner, this owner, what he does is he calls Mr. B, who is a contractor who construct the building. He says that go ahead and construct a building of this and we pay you 50 lakhs. This is a complete contract given to Mr. B, and it is B's responsibility to build this contract, this build office, and hand over it to factory owner. Okay, so the entire direction, everything, the requirement was given by these people, but the entire operation, direction, everything will be given by B to his employees to construct the building. If anything happens here, the factory owner is not responsible, the contractor is responsible for it. So from the factory perspective, this independent contractor is not an employee. Okay, temporary driver hired in place of a permanent driver for few days is considered as an employee. Okay, is considered as an employee. If any temporary driver is hired in place of a permanent driver might have gone for leave. Okay, in that case, if they hire some other person, then it will be called as employee only. A cleaner working in a transport vehicle in transport company will also be treated as employee. So cleaning of a transport vehicle is part of their business only, right? This job is related to their business and their trade. So that's why a cleaner working in a transport vehicle company is also called as employee. A watchman guarding the pumping station. Guarding of a pumping station is also important work. And if he is guarding this particular pumping station, then that person will also be called as an employee. A chowkidar of a development authority will also be called as an employee. Okay guys, the final part of the employee definition section. We saw the employee definition which is given in section 2.1 DD earlier. And here this is a schedule 2 where they define that who all are will be considered or who are a subject to a provision of section 2.1 DD. Who all will be considered as an employee under the provision of section 2.1 DD. This is the big list of details, like a big list of work nature which will be considered as an employee. Employees working in construction, factories, any factories which is using mechanical power, and then making, altering, repairing, ornamenting, finishing, and then they are in a transport, and then those who are in a mines. These all are various areas where people are working, right? Even in a transportation where loading, unloading, fueling, constructing, all this is a very, very lengthy list which contains almost 40 plus roles. This as an employee, this runs for 3 pages here. You can download this particular details in BEAR Act, Schedule 2 of this Employees Compensation Act of 1923. A person working in plantation, lighthouse, and then plantation like rubber, tea, etc. All these things are working in a warehouse. This will be called as an employees. Okay. Even they say, right, employees worked as a watchman in any factory, employed in handling animals like horses, mules, bulls. So this is a very lengthy definition. I'm saying it multiple times, but yes. So totally we have something like 47 areas or 47 nature of work which will be considered as an employee. Okay. So that's it from the definition of a dependent and employee perspective. So we discussed who is dependent and who is employee. Right? These 2 points we discussed. Here there are 3 categories. First category, second and third. First category deals with only a minor, widower, widower and son less than 18 years. He should be legitimate or adopted. Then unmarried daughter and then widowed mother. This is the first category. Second one, if they are less than, even if they are more than 18 years, but if they are of unsound mind, some physically ill, so in that case also, whether it is a son or a daughter, they will be considered as a dependent. And the third category is a huge list where we see father and then widowed daughter-in-law, then dependent brothers, dependent sisters, unmarried sisters, dependent sister. This is a big list. Okay, this is the first part of the dependent side, and we also looked into some case studies. And then we heard like who is employee. Employee, one is on a railway employee, and the second one is on a transportation side. We saw it is a person who is working in ships, then aircraft, and then any other motor vehicle or any other companies. And then the list as per schedule 2, they will be called an employee. That's it about dependent and employee definition. And in the next video, we are going to discuss about definition of an employer and other related terms. Thank you guys. Please subscribe this channel, and we will be keep posting videos on labor laws. Thank you very much.